My name's Rick. I'm an alcoholic.
Bob, I'm an alcoholic. What we're going to do might be a little different from what's been going on. I'm not sure what you've been doing from year to year, but we're gonna go through Chapter 5, and we're going to spend the next few hours together doing that. So we'll start on page 58 of the big book, but I want to read something before we get started also. We're going to go through this line by line, and we're going to have some questions at the end of tomorrow night, rather than try and do it in the middle of the workshop here, what we're going to put on. So tomorrow night after the night meeting, well, if you got some questions or something that you want to ask, just write them down and we'll address it then. I think we'll answer a lot of your questions as we go through this material. We'll see what happens. We'll see how this goes. But I want to read something before we get started. This is the foreword as it appeared in the first printing of the first edition in 1939. So this is what they wanted to tell us when they wrote the book. It says, "We of Alcoholics Anonymous are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body." That's what we've recovered from. We're no longer seemingly hopeless. So it says, "To show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book." So they wrote the book to show us precisely what they did that worked. First 100 people put this together. They hammered out these ideas in that first 3 years or so of sobriety that these guys had achieved. None of this is written from theory. It's all written from their collective experiences. They've recovered. We're not recovering. We have recovered. They say this over and over. So am I cured of alcoholism then? No, we're not cured of alcoholism, it says in step 10. What we really have is a daily reprieve contingent upon the maintenance of our spiritual condition. So what does that mean, the maintenance of our spiritual condition? Well, that's what we're going to get at. We're going to take a look at what it means to maintain our spiritual condition through this process, okay? I came to believe after I did inventory, not before. I couldn't force myself to believe in things I didn't believe in. I had to take some actions and see what happened. So we're going to go over this, take a look at what they did, precisely what they did to recover from alcoholism. I think it's a big deal, the difference between theory and experience. I'll give you an example of why it's important to me in particular. Years ago, when I first got sober, I was an atheist, and I had a lot of trouble trying to grasp spiritual ideas. I'd been a militant atheist all my life, and I was aggressive with it. I wasn't fooling around. I was hammering on people in bars, and anybody who was a Christian, I was mean-spirited. It was terrible. It was really terrible. But this is the way I was. I'm not proud of that. It's just a fact, okay? And I was watching a video of a guy named Arthur Young who invented a helicopter. Now, he said he'd been an inventor all his life. He was probably in his 80s when this aired, and it was on a program called Thinking Aloud, okay? And he said they had theories of how the helicopter should fly. Their theories were based in logic. It should work. If we do certain things, A, B, C by D should follow. Logically, it should work. He said often when they would do this, when they'd invent things, whatever it was, they'd build a model of their theory, like a small helicopter, and then fly it to see if it worked. He said, often when they did this, the model didn't obey their theories. In other words, it didn't work the way they thought it would. But they didn't say that their theories were right and the experience was wrong. They adapted their theories to the experience. The experience is what was true. Now, any logical mind would do that. Not me. You know what I was doing all my life? Prior to coming into AA, and after I was in for a while, and probably still fall into that trap once in a while, I tried to get the world to adapt to my theories. I get sober, I think, I just got to work it harder. It's logical. It should work. After all, it makes sense. I get sober and I start pouring more energy into trying to force solutions and things to work the way I thought they should. And you know what happened? It got worse. My life got worse. Never did it occur to me to stop doing what I was doing. Why? Because it was logical. It made sense. It should work, but it wasn't working. See, this has been a great barrier to spiritual growth for me. this guy had enough sense to adapt his theories to the experience. Oh no, I'm going to try and adapt my experiences to my theories, see, trying to force it to go the way I think it should. So, one of the problems for me has been, I won't try things that don't make sense, because they're not logical. Much of what we'll read in chapter 5 may not make sense, but it works if a guy tries it, see. But logic will keep me from trying things that don't make logical sense. And conversely, it will keep me hanging on to things that do make sense that are killing me. This has really been a problem for me. So what we're going to do is try and go with what these guys wrote. We're not going to argue about whether or not the book is accurate. Let's just assume these guys knew what they were talking about, because after all, they did write their collective experiences. Now, Bob and I have been doing these workshops for quite a while. And one of the things I think that's another idea I think that's interesting. He used to tell him about the Guthrie Theater, about your experience
there. Yeah, I've been a musician all my life, and I had written music for films and commercials and things like that, but I'd never done a show, a live play. I'd played them as a musician, but I'd never written music for one. And we have a theater in Minneapolis called the Guthrie Theater. And I got commissioned to write a music score for a play at the Guthrie Theater, and so we did it, and we rehearsed, and I was sitting up in the control room with the director of the show, and the first performances are going on, and he said, I'm going to go do a show in Connecticut, I'll be gone for about 6 weeks, and then I'll be back. I said, the show's on stage, what are you coming back for? What's up with that? Because I didn't know how live shows work. See, what are you coming back for? He said, oh, I have to come back periodically to take out the improvements. Not all actors are alcoholics, but actors tend to act like alcoholics sometimes, and I'm going to make my part a little better. You know, the director comes back in 6 weeks and he doesn't recognize the show anymore. So he says, I got to come back and take out the improvements. A lot of improvements in this chapter that we're going to read tonight.
No, I mean, there's a lot of things that people have made improvements on over the years. And after a while, you end up with a fellowship that doesn't even resemble what's in the Alcoholics Anonymous book. And that, I think, has happened, unfortunately, to some degree. So what I'm trying to do for myself and for guys that I sponsor is try and take out the improvements. Let's look at what the book says. Not what Rick or Bob say, but what does the book say? So we're going to go through this line by line. We're going to see if we can get at what the book actually says, because I've had some tendency to distort some of this stuff over the years, okay? So we're going to start on page 58. Chapter 5 is titled How It Works, because this is how it works. So Bob is going to read, and we're going to interrupt him off and on.
You know, when I first came into Alcoholics Anonymous, I said to a friend of mine who happened to be a minister, I said, well, this big book, this is sort of the Bible of Alcoholics Anonymous, isn't it? He said, no, this is not a Bible. If anything, it's a textbook. But you know what it really is? It's a diary. What they did was they wrote down what they did that worked. This is a chronicle of their experience. That's all. That's what it is. This is they wrote down, they told us what they did that worked.
Well, that's really what Emmett Fox in his book, The Sermon on the Mount, he said, the acid test for truth is, does it work? Now, that's a book that had a big impact on early AA before they wrote the big book. Dr. Bob and Bill were both Emmett Fox fans, and they would subscribe to people reading that text, The Sermon on the Mount. Well, in there he says the acid test for truth is, does it work? Not is it logical, but does it work? Let's take a look at what they wrote.
So when we talk about the improvements, you will hear things as we're reading through this line by line. You'll hear things that don't square with stuff that you may have heard at meetings or stuff that you may have heard other people say. So, and that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to be reading this a line at a time and looking at it. So chapter 5, how it works. Rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program, usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves.
You know how I heard that originally? Honest with everybody else. Then I set out to become rigorously, rigidly honest with everybody else. You know, I was like the guy who quits smoking and then wants you to quit smoking, you know? The guy who quits drinking wants to hammer you over his... You know, this is the way I was. See, got to be honest. Got to be rigorously honest. I'll stop lying. I'll stop stealing. I'll be working a program. Okay? And I believe that that's what we were talking about. And, you know, I've come to realize over the years that I've had a lot of company with that idea. Lots of us have thought that. Yeah. I'll be working a program if I just stop stealing and lying. But, you know, as you get into this material a little bit, you know what we're talking about here? We're talking about how dishonest I am with myself. Now, I heard somebody say this one time years ago, many, when I was early sobriety. He said something to the effect that you got to be honest with yourself. And I thought, come on, I don't lie to myself. Certainly I tell others lies. I'm dishonest with others, but I tell myself the truth. I don't lie to myself. I believe that with all my heart at that moment. See, what we're really talking about is self-deception. Now, you might say, well, I don't have self-deception. I'd say, really? How do you know? Well, how do you know? Isn't self-deception the guy who's got it doesn't know it? I mean, think about it. The guy who's self-deceived doesn't know he's self-deceived until he gets past it. You ever been wrong when you were sure you were right?
Sure.
Yeah. You know, you get some information later on. Here, I'll give you a real simple one that happened to me early on in my life. I was drinking with a guy in my living room, just met him that day. I was about 18 years old. We were drinking, got drunk that night. I black out. You know, I always black out when I drink. I woke up the next morning, he's gone, my money's gone. This guy ripped me off. So I called the people who introduced me to him, and I want to find this guy. I'd like to have a little talk with him. You know, I looked around, we didn't buy any pizzas or anything. There were no boxes. I don't remember going anywhere, so my money's gone. So I slammed him to 2-3 people. Different phone calls, see? Told him he was a thief, that sort of thing. Nobody seemed to know him. They just blew in, grabbed my money, and blew out. Well, a couple of months went by. I found my money. I hid it when I was drunk, and I forgot where I put it. Now, clearly I'm wrong, okay? When I would have bet anything, I was right. Now, do you think I called the people up I slammed them to? Oh, of course not. No, no, no. You know, I don't admit anything. You think I'm going to admit it after a couple of months? I mean, you could see me do something and I deny it. You think I'm going to admit it now? Of course not. So I leave that perception out there for that guy to deal with. I'm guilty. I know I'm a jerk. I have no integrity. I won't deal with this stuff. But I know I'm wrong. And I'm just a jerk. I won't deal with it at all. And I'm guilty. And you know what I found? How you can get over that? You can drink those thoughts away. Okay, you can just overpower them. I used to do things like that, knowing full well that I caused this guy some problem. People gossip. Who knows where that went? And he had to deal with that at some point, probably. I don't know. I hoped I never saw him or them again, and I never did see him again. But I never cleaned that up, see? So you just drink those thoughts away. But do they ever really go anywhere? You know, that came floating back up probably about, I don't know, 12 years ago. I'd forgotten about it, but it came back. You know, the guilt was still there, the remorse about what I did. Isn't that something? Now, what if a guy's got a lot of that stuff and it comes floating up as he stays sober? You know, ultimately what happens to most of us, and I'm sure many of you guys have had this experience. If you haven't, you probably will. You go along in sobriety and you become increasingly uncomfortable as you stay sober. And if you don't deal with this stuff through a process of inventory, what generally happens is you'll hit a point where sobriety starts to look like a problem and a drink starts to look like a solution again, see? And that happens. And that's when you're in dangerous territory. And it happens to many of us. Probably all of us at some point, you hit those points if you don't deal with this stuff through a process of inventory. Well, that's what we're going to get at, is how do you maintain a spiritual condition, see, when you've got this sort of thing. So, if you've ever been wrong when you were sure you were right, and I think if we're honest at all with ourselves, everybody's had experiences like that, then I would ask this. How many things could I be wrong about right now and I haven't found out yet? I mean, it's a possibility, isn't it? If I've been wrong before when I was sure I was right, it's possible I could be living under a lot of illusions about what I think I'm right about, and it just hasn't been revealed yet. This is the essence of inventory in Alcoholics Anonymous. You know what we're going to look at? As we go through this material, we're going to look at the stories we tell ourselves that justify our anger. You can't be angry without a story. In fact, the story is the justification for it. So we're going to re-examine these stories through a process of inventory and take a look at this stuff. Why would I do that? Because the anger is hurting me, not the guy I'm angry at. It's not hurting the other person. It's like looking at my dad and saying, well, Dad, I see what a jerk you've been to me. I think I'll hold negative thoughts in my mind about you and hurt myself. Oh, isn't that brilliant? I'm going to hurt myself because I'm angry at other people. I'm actually going to cause pain to my own mind by the way I think about things. And then we sit around. I don't know about out here, but in Minnesota you'll hear guys say, you know, I used to hear it frequently years ago. We'd sit around in AA rooms and we'd say, you know, alcoholics are above average intelligence.
You don't hear that at Al-Anon meetings.
No, Al-Anon. They've got a different view of us. I know, I go to Al-Anon. Been there for 24 years. So we're going to look at this stuff. We're going to start to examine. But the first idea here is I have to be honest with myself. I found I can be very honest with others and very dishonest with myself. This was an amazing revelation to me when I started to see this. So it doesn't matter how long you've been sober. You can be sober a long time and have a lot of this going on. And I'll give you another story later on about that, something that happened to me.
I'll give you a quick example of a delusion. I once got a traffic ticket for being honest. Late at night, I'm coming out of an alley, there's a one-way street, and if I go the one way that I'm supposed to go, I got to go around about six blocks, or if I go the wrong way on purpose, I got a half a block and then I'm right where I want to be. So there's nobody around, I'm going to just... So I come out of the alley, I turn the wrong way on the one-way street, I get to the corner, there's a squad car. So he pulls me over. He says, sir, are you aware that you just went the wrong way on a one-way street? Now, I know if I had lied to the cop, he probably would have let me go, right? But I got to be rigorously honest. So I said, yes, sir, I turned the corner and I knew I did it on purpose. Well, then I guess I'll have to give you a ticket. So I told that story. And Rick had heard that story. And early on when I first started doing workshops with Rick, I'm telling that story and he's looking at me like, you're not really going to tell that line of BS again, are you? I get a traffic ticket for being honest. I get a traffic ticket for breaking a traffic law. Okay. The delusion was, well, if I hadn't told him the truth, I would. You know, I get a traffic ticket for breaking the law, which I richly deserved. Okay. So.
See, that'll justify a lot of other lies, then, won't it?
Yeah.
You see. See how you can justify things off of that one thing. Well, if I'm honest, there'll be that sort of problem.
So self-honesty. People who don't recover are people who can't be honest with themselves. There are such unfortunates. They are not at fault. They seem to have been born that way. They are naturally incapable of grasping and developing a manner of living which demands rigorous honesty. Their chances are less than average.
Boy, how many guys have hung on those lines, huh? I'm one of those who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with myself. Well, you know, it just says your chances are less than average. What's average? 50-50? What are you, 60-40? 75-25? Maybe you're 85-15. I don't know. 95-5? You still have a chance, don't you? Okay? If you're willing to look, you have a chance. So you can't really even hang on those lines.
There are those, too, who suffer from grave emotional and mental disorders, but many of them do recover if they have the capacity to be honest.
See, I used to think that sentence was people who weren't staying sober. Yeah, that guy's got, because he can't stay sober, he's got grave emotional and mental disorders. You know what I've come to realize? I've been sober a while now. Everybody in AA has got grave emotional and mental disorders. That's how you get here. Unless you guys came in on a winning streak, I don't know about you, but, wow.
Yeah, if you're ever in Minneapolis, come to our home group, you'll feel right at home. Grave emotional and mental disorders.
And they're staying sober. It's astonishing. And I mean, these guys are something. Some of them are really nuts, man.
Our stories disclose in a general way what we used to be like, what happened, and what we are like now. If you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go to any length to get it, then you are ready to take certain steps.
See, a lot of guys aren't ready to take certain steps. And I'm willing that he goes to any lengths and takes certain steps. And Bob's willing that... But a lot of guys come in, and they're just not there. They're not ready. And we push at them and shove at them. And it's unfortunate because you can push a guy right out of the program that way. Sometimes you got to step back and just let a guy have his experience. I was just working with a guy who was coming in and drinking off and on and off and on. And I knew if he kept coming back, see, And I didn't push at him. I just let him be, and eventually he stopped. It took him a little bit, but eventually he stopped, see? So it's important for me not to get aggressive with those guys and beat them over the head with the big book and that sort of thing. Al-Anon's helped me a lot with that. I got into Al-Anon when I was 3 months sober, and it's made me safer as a sponsor or if I'm working with somebody. It's just made me safer because I'm less aggressive. I understand. Just let him have his experience. Don't try and force it. You might push him right away from AA entirely.
And it might be sad to think that, but there's really nothing you can do about it. I cannot make anybody else sober. We heard, who was it, Frank, one of the speakers. We just had our big roundup in Minnesota over the weekend. And one of the speakers said this: nobody else can make me drink. Nobody else can make me be sober. It's my choice. It's up to me to do what I'm going to do. If I could sponsor you and make you sober, I would do it in a minute. But I don't have the power to make somebody sober. All I can do is push him away from Alcoholics Anonymous.
Yeah, no way.
I've done that, by the way. So.
And the way he said, I heard him in Crested Butte talk this way. He's talking to the newcomers in the group, and Frank's been sober a long time. And he says everybody in this room is going to get in one of two lines. You're going to get in the line of people who stay sober, and or in the line of people who would drink again. And he says, you know who's going to make that decision? You are. He says, your boss can't make it. Your wife or lack of wife can't make it. Nobody can make that choice or decision but me. And he says, you guys who don't stay sober, you know why you won't stay sober? Because you cannot or will not completely give yourself to this simple program. And he's right. That's what it'll be. Either I cannot or I will not. You see it all the time. I've seen a lot of guys who just will not do it.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen a couple who couldn't. And one guy got sober that I know who just couldn't do it. And something shifted in him one day. And it's astonishing when you see that. In fact, he got well when I quit helping him. I was working on him for some time, dragging him around to meetings and doing all this stuff with him. He's an older guy. And I couldn't help him. And finally, I just kind of gave up. I just knew I couldn't help him. And something shifted in him. It was the damnedest thing. I had nothing to do with it, really. It was one day, something happened, he made a decision, and he got sober. In spite of my help, he got well.
Our stories disclose in a general way what we used to be like, what happened, and what we are like now. If you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go to any length to get it, then you are ready to take certain steps. At some of these we balked. We thought we could find an easier, softer way, but we could not. With all the earnestness at our command, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. Some of us have tried to hold on to our old ideas, and the result was nil until we let go absolutely.
It's an interesting line, isn't it? Some of us have tried to hold on to our old ideas. Is there anybody in here who has not tried to hold on to an old idea? Okay. Yeah, but some of us have tried. Isn't that? It's kind of funny, isn't it? You know, what are we talking about? Because this is really strong language. Be told anything. See? So, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. Wow. That's pretty strong. So, old ideas about what? What are we talking about? Old ideas. Okay? Now, when I got sober, I remember thinking, well, I'll hang on to my good old ideas and let go of my bad old ideas. Okay? Now, everybody was doing that, I'm sure, long before they walked into AA. So there must be some confusion about what's a good old idea and what's a bad old idea, right? You understand? Well, that's what I was doing. I thought I could determine that. Well, I really believe that it helps infinitely. It really helps if you just challenge everything. You're not going to lose what's true. What's true is still going to be true whether you challenge it or not, okay? That's the thing, see? You can't lose the truth. All you can really lose is your illusions of what you want to be true. Now, that can be devastating. It really can. Especially if you've got a big case built against your dad, for example, and you've been hating on him for about 25 years, then you write some inventory and you find out you're wrong. I'll tell you some stories about that as we go along on this, what happened to me with that. So how about if we just challenge all our old ideas? The truth will still be true whether I challenge it or not.
Here's a good old idea. You want to hear a good old idea?
Oh,
I'm really generous.
This is a good one.
I'm really generous. I've always been generous. I'll help you. And I don't ask for anything in return. I'll be helpful. My family, my friends. And Until I inventoried it, I never saw this. There's a hook in there, and here's what it was. If I need some help, and you guys are not jumping up, getting in line to help me after all I've done for you, oh, man. And I would get rageful because after all I've done, I didn't even ask you for anything, but after all I've done for you, you're not getting up here to help me? That's an old idea that I never saw until I did inventory on it.
And why would you even examine that? That's a good old idea, right?
Well, everybody's been telling me how generous I am. You know, I've been hearing a lot of that. So, yeah. Why would I even look at that?
Because he was angry. Because he was in conflict with people. When you start to look, you start to see things like that.
So old ideas are not ideas from 1948. They're ideas from 2 minutes ago. And anything in my mind needs to be challenged. Constantly challenged. Does that make sense? Remember that we deal with alcohol, cunning, baffling, powerful. Without help, it is too much for us. But there is one who has all power. That one is God. May you find him now. Half measures availed us nothing. We stood at the turning point. We asked his protection and care with complete abandon. Here are the steps we took, which are suggested as a program of recovery. We admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. Made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. We're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Humbly asked him to remove our shortcomings. Made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Made direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. Continued to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. Sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood him, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. Having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Many of us exclaimed, "What an order, I can't go through with it." Do not be discouraged. No one among us has been able to maintain anything like perfect adherence to these principles. We are not saints. The point is that we are willing to grow along spiritual lines. The principles we have set down are guides to progress. We claim spiritual progress rather than spiritual perfection. Our description of the alcoholic.
Okay, that's the first three chapters in this book. That's our description of the alcoholic.
The chapter to the agnostic.
That's chapter 4. Agnostic comes from the root word gnosis, which means knowing. Agnostic means don't know. Don't know if there's a power greater than myself. Chapter 4 is designated to the guy who doesn't know.
And our personal adventures before and after make clear three pertinent ideas. A, that we were alcoholic and could not manage our own lives.
That's step 1, isn't it? It's another way of saying we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable.
B, that probably no human power could have relieved our alcoholism.
That's step 2, right? No human power. Yeah. So it's just another way of looking at step 2. So that's really how AA started, was on B, when the doctors gave up on us. They couldn't help Bill. They couldn't help Roland Hazard, Dr. Carl Jung, who'd been working with him before Bill got sober in Switzerland, trying to help him stay sober through the Oxford groups. It was before he met the Oxford groups, I'm sorry. But Roland Hazard carried that message to Abby Thatcher, who carried it to Bill eventually. But Dr. Jung gave up on him, just like Silkworth did on Bill in that hospital. You're beyond human aid. That's right.
And see that God could and would if he were sought.
Okay, that's step 2.5, right? Yeah, 2.5.
Being convinced we were at step 3.
See?
We would not lie about a thing like that. Which is that we decided to turn our will and our life over to God as we understood him. Just what do we mean by that, and just what do we do?
Yeah, what do we mean by the third step, and just what do we do? Now this, I got to tell you, when I walked into AA, we've got, in all our meeting rooms at our club where I started out, we've got them all on the wall. We've taken them and put them on these plaques on the wall. Joe and Charlie talked about this, okay? When you take the steps out of the book and put them on the wall, you lose the process. There's a process in here. When I looked at step three, I immediately felt, well, first of all, I'm an atheist, so I'm not interested in that at all. But the other thing is, I felt like you have to lose something. I got to give something up. I mean, if I really turn my will and life over to God, I mean, what if I'm a Catholic? I mean, doesn't that mean you shouldn't have sex before you're married? Well, I certainly don't want that, all right? So I don't really want to turn my will and life over to God. I've got to give something up, right? Isn't that the sense you get from that? You know, this is an old idea from very old with me. About a year ago, as recent as a year ago, I'd read this so many times, and I'm thinking, I wonder why did I have this negativity around this? I mean, besides being an atheist at the time, okay? Why did I have all this negativity? When I was a kid, about 8 years old, we used to hang in the neighborhood with a couple other kids, and there was a young girl who we'd hang with, and she was beautiful, too. That helped. We wanted her to go out and do stuff with us, go to movies, things like that. Her parents wouldn't let her go, and they were religious. That's why she couldn't do the things that we were doing, for whatever reason. And I, at 8 years old, you got to give something up if you're actually religious or you have anything to do with God. I carried that all through my life. One day it dawns on me what it was, why I had this negative feeling. Well, I think a lot of us have it for various reasons, but it started real early. I carried that all through my adult life till one day it dawns on me. My God, that's what it was. Got to lose something if I actually turn my will and life over to God. Can't have any fun, right? Isn't that what you think? Sure. So you hold a little bit back all the time. Well, when you look at this out of the book, it looks very different. The question that's going to be on the table now for a few paragraphs is going to be, just what do we mean by that and just what do we do? So what do we mean by turning our will and life over to God? And what do we do? Well, here it goes.
The first requirement is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. On that basis, we are almost always in collision with something or somebody, even though our motives are good.
Think about this. You know, these are sentences that I used to slide over. I didn't think much of it. I sort of had an inkling of what they were talking about, but I didn't want to think very deeply. You know, I was lazy intellectually. Especially when I first got sober. It was just terrible. I wanted other people to think for me. I got to tell you, that's a good way to get brainwashed around Alcoholics Anonymous by well-meaning people, is to not do your own thinking. The last thing I want to do with guys is to brainwash them. I just don't want to do it. I want to show them another way of looking, to thinking about things, but not just because I say it doesn't mean it's true. I could be full of crap. I've frequently been. Could be today. Okay, so the first requirement of turning my will and life over to God is that I be convinced that my life run on Rick's will, self-will, can hardly be a success. It was not a success. I failed at everything I did. It was not a success. So self-will, Rick's will. Well, on that basis, we are almost always in collision with something or somebody, even though our motives are good. Hey, I had good motives. I was trying to keep a roof over my kids' head and food on the table as I was out stealing and lying and cheating you guys. Did you like it when you come in contact with a guy like me? No. People react negatively to it, don't they? You don't like it when somebody's manipulating you for their gain and they're justifying it by, well, I'm just trying to take care of my family, you know. That's a good motive, isn't it? But not what I'm doing with it. So I ended up in collision or conflict with others when I was living out of self-will. That's as true today as it was before I came into AA. If I start doing that, I start bumping into conflict with people.
Most people try to live by self-propulsion.
Sure. So other people live this way, don't they? It's not just alcoholics that are this way. Other people live on self-propulsion. Our society's very self-willed. It's all over in our culture. How come I end up in treatment centers? How come I've got to go to jail on occasion? How come they got to remove me from society and put me in a cage periodically? Because I can't, you know, that's what jail is. Because I can't be trusted to be with the rest of the society. See? They have to jail me. Other people act this way, too, to some degree. You know what I realized one day? Drunks just do this with more enthusiasm than others. You know what I'm saying? Everything's full speed ahead, isn't it? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Remember the 60s, huh? Yeah, well, you weren't there if you remember them. I mean, really. Honest to God, everything is full speed ahead with me. I don't half measure anything. It's astonishing. Everybody's like that who comes into AA to some degree, or you wouldn't get here. That's how you get here, being enthusiastic. The only thing drunks don't do with enthusiasm, you know what it is? The steps. Yeah, they come in here and they go, oh, I need balance now. Why don't you do this with enthusiasm? Oh, no. Then they look at the slogans on the wall at our club. You know, it says, easy does it up there. Okay? Easy does it? Why don't you do this enthusiastically? Oh, no. Easy does it. And they use the slogans to kill themselves. It's astonishing. Wow, that is not my journey. When I came in here, I was miserable enough. I come in like a rocket. I'm going to get out of this crap. I can't stand how I feel. So I think that's really the difference. When average people bump into the conflict, they back up. They take a look at it. Not me. I try and roll over you to get what I want. And that's really what's been a major problem. So if I'm living on self-will, I'm going to end up in conflict. They're going to give us a perfect description. This next couple paragraphs is going to be an absolutely beautiful description of how the mind becomes resentful when it lives out of self-will and tries to run the show. This is a classic, the way they do this.
Here's the director talking about the improvements now. Each person is like an actor who wants to run the whole show. Is forever trying to arrange the lights, the ballet, the scenery, and the rest of the players in his own way. If his arrangements would only stay put, if only people would do as he wished, the show would be great. Everybody, including himself, would be pleased. Life would be wonderful.
Isn't that what you think? If my coworkers would just do what I tell them, can't they see I know what's best? Can't my spouse or my girlfriend, if they just do what I tell them, can't they see? Everything would be great. They just do it my way. You know, drunks will not let the boss be the boss. Have you noticed that? They get sober, they get a job, you know, probably the first time in a long time, and they're there for a couple weeks and they're telling the boss how to run his company to the point where he has to fire them because he just can't stand it. They will not let the boss be the boss. Got to tell them how to do it. If they just do what I tell them, can't they see I know what's best? Well, look what happens when you live that way.
We have a friend in our group who's really a bright guy, and he has said this in sharing in meetings. His boss has told him, you are the best person at this job that I've ever had. You're fired because you're such a pain in the neck. You're the best person I've ever had. You're fired.
Yeah, he's one of these Mensa guys, big brain, you know. Oh, that's rough. That's rough. It's, you know, the guys with big brains have a lot of trouble with this stuff.
Yes, we do.
Bury those guys.
What do they say? You can be too smart for Alcoholics Anonymous. I've never seen anybody too dumb for Alcoholics Anonymous.
Yeah.
This stuff's pretty easy to get. You know, it is simple. People say it's simple. Trust me, it's simple.
So everybody, including himself, would be pleased. Life would be wonderful if they just do what I tell them.
In trying to make these arrangements, our actor may sometimes be quite virtuous.
Sure.
He may be kind, considerate, patient, generous, even modest and self-sacrificing.
Yeah, as long as you're doing what I want. I'll be that way. I'll be kind, considerate, patient, generous. I'll even give a little. I'll be modest and self-sacrificing, as long as you're doing it the way I think you should.
On the other hand, he may be mean, egotistical, selfish, and dishonest.
That's when it didn't work the other way.
But as with most humans, he is more likely to have varied traits.
As with most humans. Doesn't say alcoholics, does it? This is the human condition. This has nothing to do with alcohol. This is what humans do. The only problem with us, I believe, is that we just do it with a lot of enthusiasm. So if you're doing things that are hurting you with enthusiasm, guess what? you get your rear kicked enthusiastically is what happens, see?
What usually happens? The show doesn't come off very well.
Yeah, I ended up in treatment.
He begins to think life doesn't treat him right.
You ever felt that way?
He decides to exert himself more. He becomes, on the next occasion, still more demanding or gracious, as the case may be.
I'll become more demanding to get what I want, or I'll become more gracious. I'll try and manipulate through kindness, so-called.
Still, the play does not suit him. Admitting he may be somewhat at fault, he is sure that other people are more to blame.
Well, can you hear the anger starting?
See, this is the alcoholic's creed, isn't it? My life sucks and it's all your fault.
I'm willing to admit I'm somewhat at fault, but I'm sure you're more to blame. I wish I had a buck for every time I had that thought over my lifetime.
He becomes angry, indignant, self-pitying. What is his basic trouble? Is he not really a self-seeker even when trying to be kind?
Well, that's rough to look at, isn't it? I'm a self-seeker even when I'm being kind. What am I in my worst moments? A real pain to people. Okay, and I'm totally unaware of this. All I see is people's reactions.
Is he not a victim of the delusion that he can wrest satisfaction and happiness out of this world if he only manages well?
I'm a victim of my own delusion that if I get things arranged properly, I'll be happy.
Is it not evident to all the rest of the players that these are the things he wants? And do not his actions make each of them wish to retaliate, snatching all they can get out of the show? Is he not, even in his best moments, a producer of confusion rather than harmony?
Wow. Isn't this amazing? I'm a producer of confusion rather than harmony, because sometimes I'm kind, considerate, patient, generous, and then I turn. If I don't get what I want doing that, I become aggressive. Did you see the movie about Ike and Tina Turner called What's Love Got to Do with It? Oh, man, I'm telling you, this is a great movie. You want to see this played out. Ike Turner was a very talented musician. He was pretty good to Tina. As long when she came on board, you know, he was playing on his own. When she came on, their careers took off like a rocket. He knew it was her. He wasn't stupid. He knew she was the impetus on this. He's out screwing around. He's pretty good to her, but he's screwing around with other women. You know, they have children, they're married, all of a sudden they got kids and a family and all this stuff, and he wants to run around with other women, and he's doing a lot of drugs, and he's not coming home and all this stuff. But he was pretty good to her as long as she played her part properly. Then when she says, I'm done, now this took years, the movie is incredible, took years, and finally she gets to a point and says, no more. What's he do? He starts to beat her up. Starts to threaten her, scare her, beat her up to keep her. Isn't that interesting? I'll beat you up to keep you. I'll threaten you to stay with me. It was a nightmare. Well, she left. She left. He went down the tubes, too, after that. Took a while, but he went down. So here it was playing out, you know. He was pretty good to her as long as she did what he wanted her to do. And do not my actions make others wish to retaliate. The outcome of living selfishly or self out of self-will is what? Anger for the person who's selfish or living on self-will. I end up in conflict, collision with something or somebody. This is a description of how the mind becomes resentful. It's an absolute perfect description of the process.
So our actor is self-centered, egocentric, as people like to call it nowadays.
Yeah, now what does self-centered and egocentric look like? These are sentences that I used to just slide past, didn't want to think very deeply about it, lazy, you know. What does it mean? They give us examples of what they're talking about here. I'd never read them very well until I started reading it to other people a lot, and I realized, my God, this is perfect.
He is like the retired businessman who lolls in the Florida sunshine in the winter, complaining of the sad state of the nation.
Can you get a picture of that? He's a retired businessman, right? He's lulling in the Florida sunshine in the winter. Now, that sounds pretty good in wintertime, doesn't it? Lull in the Florida sunshine? But he's complaining about the sad state of the nation. Well, what's he complaining about? He's got it pretty good. Thinks he knows what's best. Going to tell everybody else how to live. See what it is? Self-centered, egocentric.
The minister who sighs over the sins of the 20th century.
Oh, yeah. Look at what they're doing now. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you know, the 60s.
Politicians and reformers who are sure all would be utopia if the rest of the world would only behave. Pick up a paper. Turn on the TV. The outlaw safecracker who thinks society has wronged him.
That's an interesting one because I think it's particularly telling. Think about this. The outlaw safecracker who thinks society has wronged him. He's cracking safes, justifying it by, well, society's wronged me. I got every right to steal. You see, it's interesting because I used to do that with people I'd work for. Whenever I'd have a job with somebody, maybe the guy promised me promotions and things like that, and I wouldn't get them because I wouldn't show up for work. I'm late. I'm drunk. And I'm just a problem on the job. And then I'd justify my stealing. Well, you know, he didn't give me that raise he promised me. Well, I didn't deserve it, see. But I didn't look at that. I just looked at the fact he didn't give it to me. Well, then I'll just take his stuff. I'll steal. I'll make it up this way, see. And I would justify my stealing by he owes me. You know what I realized one day? You have to make it reasonable. Most of us. I'm not saying this 100%. But if I'm going to do something that I know is wrong, I have to tell myself a story of why it's justified to do it. See? Oh, yeah. You make it reasonable. And I think the reason for that is I think the mind naturally wants to love. And to get it to do something that you know is wrong, you got to justify it somehow. That guy cheated me. He did this. He did that. You know, whatever it is. Wow. The outlaw safecracker who thinks society has wronged him.
And the alcoholic who has lost all and is locked up. Whatever our protestations, are not most of us concerned with ourselves, our resentments, or our self-pity?
Now, what do I protest about? You ever look at what you protest about during the course of your week or your day? What do I gripe about? Isn't it about something that concerns me personally? Yeah. If I'm a Republican, don't I want laws that are passed that will benefit my interests? Yeah. If I'm a Democrat, don't I want laws that are passed that will benefit my interests and what I believe? Yeah, of course. Doesn't matter which side you're on. It's irrelevant. So, when I don't get what I want, are not most of us concerned with ourselves, our resentments, or our self-pity? Yeah. I want things the way I think they should be. I can't accept what is. And I'm constantly trying to maneuver and manipulate outcomes that just and satisfy what I want out of life. And you know what happens? People don't like that. They react negatively to that. And this next line is astonishing when you start to look at this.
Selfishness, self-centeredness, that we think is the root of our troubles.
Wow, what happened to booze? You mean alcohol's not the problem? Well, then why am I sitting in AA meetings talking about not drinking all the time then? How about that? Why do we sit around and talk about not drinking if alcohol's not the problem? If selfishness and self-centeredness is the problem? Because that's more personal, isn't it? It's a little more difficult to say, hey, I'm selfish. But yet, we talk about the symptom instead. Well, look at where this goes.
Driven by 100 forms of fear, self-delusion, self-seeking, and self-pity, we step on the toes of our fellows and they retaliate.
Is that what's been going on in my life? I'm stepping on the toes of my fellows and they're retaliating? You know, I looked the word selfish up. I'm going to give you a Webster's Dictionary. It comes out of the Collegiate Dictionary. It is word for word. Selfish. Concerned excessively or exclusively with oneself. Concerned excessively or exclusively with oneself. Seeking or concentrating on one's own advantage, pleasure, or well-being without concern for others. So that's what selfish means. I'm looking for an advantage, aren't you? Some pleasure, some well-being. And in achieving that, I don't consider other people. It's not that I don't care about other people. I'm so wrapped up in what I want that I don't consider others. How could I if I'm concerned excessively and exclusively with me? So I'm driven by 100 forms of fear. What am I afraid of? I'm afraid I won't get what I want. I'm selfish. Right? I'm afraid I'll lose what I got. I'm selfish. I'm trying to possess her or things. So I'm driven by 100 forms of fear of losing what I got or not getting what I want. Self-delusion. I distort things. Self-seeking. I'm only concerned about Rick. And self-pity. I feel sorry for myself when I don't get what I want. What happens? I step on the toes of my fellows. They retaliate. Then I look at their retaliation. And I think, what a jerk. Look at the way he's treating me. You see, I have no awareness that I'm like this. All I see is the way he's acting toward me. And I look at him, I think, Bob, look at the way he's treating me. And then I tell Bob the story. Now, you know how you tell the story? In just the right way so Bob will agree with me. Right? Right. I'll exaggerate certain points, like what she did. I'll minimize other points, like what I did. I'll leave relevant information entirely out of the story, because if I tell that to Bob, he won't agree with me. So I tailor the story till I get it just right. We join in our anger, and then we hate her together. Have you seen that yet? The need to tell the story? And you know what? You actually join in your woundedness, not your strengths. And you bind yourself tighter to the grievances the more you tell the stories. And you know what? After a while, I believed my own stories. I bought a ticket to my own show. And I was living in a fantasy of reality. It wasn't reality at all. And I had to take an inventory and look at these stories. Because my anger was justified by my story. See? So it's a perfect setup to kill yourself and stay drunk. Isn't it astonishing when you look at this? Wow.
So we step on the toes of our fellows and they retaliate. Sometimes they hurt us, seemingly without provocation.
Seemingly.
But we invariably find that at some time in the past we have made decisions based on self, which later placed us in a position to be hurt.
Do you understand that? I made decisions out of my selfishness, which later placed me in a position to be hurt. Look, I'm going to explain this. This has to do with a situation with drugs. I hope that I don't have to defend this somehow along the way here. I'm simply telling you this to illustrate what the book is saying. Okay? That's all it is. Doing a lot of crystal meth at one time. Got some really great speed from a guy. Best thing I ever saw. We're talking in the 80s, early 80s. Okay? $500 for an eighth of an ounce. A lot of money, man. But it was really strong and you could cut it 100%. You could double the product and it was still better than anything on the streets. Okay? So I give a buddy of mine a little taste of it. And it just blows the top of your head off straight, see? And I cut it 100%. He comes back, wants to buy some. I sell him at cut. He says, it's not the same. I said, yeah, it's the same. He says, no, it's not. I said, you want your money back? Oh, no, no. I got him over a barrel, see? This is the way I treat my friends. You see the way I am with my enemies. Yeah. You know? So I got him over a barrel on this deal. So he's angry. Now I got a conflict with him. See, you can see how the selfishness brings out the conflict. So I sell a bunch of it. I want some more. I call the guy up. He sends the guy over. He says, you want some more? I says, yeah. He says, give me the money. So I gave him $500. I never saw him again. Sometimes they hurt us, seemingly without provocation. Now, it seems like I didn't provoke that, right? The guy stole my money. He's wrong. I'm not disputing that he's wrong. But we invariably find that at some time in the past, we made decisions based on self, which later placed us in a position to be hurt. Do you understand? I made a decision out of my selfishness, out of my addiction, whatever you want to call it, to do something I would not normally do. That put me in a position to get stolen from. Even in a situation where the guy stole from me, I was wrong. I set it up. It never could have happened had I not made a decision out of my own selfishness that put me in a position to have that experience. Isn't that astonishing when you start seeing something like that? See, I was really angry at that guy, and all of a sudden it occurred to me, my God, you know who I'm angry at is myself. And I'm actually hating myself through how I see him. I'm using him to literally hurt myself by how I see him. We're going to get into this more thoroughly. You'll understand this much better before we're done with the resentment stuff here. So even in situations like that, if I can get honest with myself, sometimes they hurt us, seemingly without provocation. Well, it always seems like I didn't provoke it till I get honest.
So our troubles, we think, are basically of our own making.
You see? You see where that is?
They arise out of ourselves, and the alcoholic is an extreme example of self-will run riot, though he usually doesn't think so.
I'm an extreme example of this, and I never think it's me. It's always the other guy.
Above everything, we alcoholics must be rid of this selfishness. We muster it kills us. God makes that possible.
Isn't that amazing? Above everything, we must be rid of this selfishness. It doesn't say we must be rid of booze. Oh, no. We must be rid of the selfishness because staying sober is intolerable when you got these conflicts. And when you resolve the conflicts, sobriety becomes an easy process, see? But if I don't deal with this stuff, it's a nightmare. And sobriety starts to look like a problem, and a drink starts to look like a solution. And this can happen at any point with somebody.
And there often seems no way of entirely getting rid of self without his aid.
Without God's aid.
Many of us had moral and philosophical convictions galore, but we could not live up to them even though we would have liked to. Neither could we reduce our self-centeredness much by wishing or trying on our own power. We had to have God's help.
You know, I heard somebody years ago say, alcoholics don't have morals. I mean, this is 20-some years ago, a gal from the podium. And I was sitting in the audience and I'm thinking, that's a bunch of crap. I had tremendous moralities. And if you didn't live up to them... You understand the problem? Okay. If you didn't... I wasn't living them myself. Yet I would hammer on you if you didn't live up to my moral code. Isn't that something? Who are you hating? You're hating yourself outside of yourself. And the more you judge them, the more you're judging yourself. This is exactly what's going on. I'm hurting myself with my thoughts. What if you're an enthusiastic guy like I am? Well, then you're kicking your rear enthusiastically. This has been a problem. But once I saw it, it changed me. I've never been the same once I started to see this.
Hold this thought, guys, because you're going to see this develop all through this inventory, this idea that Rick's just talking about now. This develops all through this whole process here. This is the how and why of it. First of all, we had to quit playing God. It didn't work. Next, we decided that hereafter in this drama of life, God was going to be our director. He is the principal, we are his agents, he is the father, and we are his children. Most good ideas are simple, and this concept was the keystone of the new and triumphant arch through which we passed to freedom.
What if you don't believe? What if you're an atheist like I was? What do you do with this stuff then? See, I didn't come to believe until after I did inventory, not before. How are you going to find an experience of love with a head full of hate? You might find a concept, but an experience? Uh-uh. Not of love when you're hating. Just isn't possible. They're opposites. I had to get the anger out of the way, but I didn't believe in God. So what do you do with this? Let me tell you something that happened to me. This is one of the most significant things that happened to me. I was 3 weeks sober. My life was a mess. I lost my family. I had an 11-year relationship with Pam and two kids. I was fixing my relationship. She took the kids and left. I was fixing my finances. I lost the house we were living in. Foreclosure. $50,000 in equity in one house. That was a lot of money in the 80s. I lost my business. I had a business that I was working on. Moved that around town a bit. Antique plumbing fixtures. That's a nightmare in story in itself. I'll tell you a little of that later. Every time I fixed something, it got worse. I was trying to go to outpatient treatment to get my family back, okay, before I went into this real treatment center. And I had no interest in stopping using. I was just in there to get my stuff back. I wanted my family back. I wanted my money back. I wanted my house back. I wanted my stuff back. See, I wasn't interested in changing. I don't know. I thought I could manipulate everybody to come back and put it all back together, and I didn't have to change anything, see. So I go across the street to the Social Security office, okay? I used to make up birth certificates. I had an impression stamp. I used to sell identities. We were involved in all kinds of illegal stuff. I wanted Social Security cards to go with the birth certificates. I leave a treatment center. I'm using all the time a minute, you know, of course. I go across the street, climb up into the ceiling of the bathroom, wait for them to close, come down. I'm going to do what this... I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm insane, okay? I do nothing. They close. I start digging through desks. I'm going to steal a bunch of stuff. It's a federal building. It's all alarmed. You got to break out. You know what I mean? You're going to trip an alarm going out, but I'm already in, so I'm just doing all this stuff while I'm in there. Lose track of time. It's about 4 in the morning. I got to get out of there. I open the computer room up. Alarm goes off. The cops come, and I hide in the ceiling for 2.5 days from the cops. Had some time to think. Things weren't going very well. Every time I fixed something, it got worse. Now it looks like I'm going to prison for a long time. I got to a bottom in a ceiling, of all places. Okay? I did. I saw something I'd never seen before. You know what it was? People have been telling me this for years. You're out of control, Rick. You have lost the ability to control what you do. You cannot not do the things you're doing. I'm in and out of courtrooms, in and out of jails. So my life's a disaster. And I got out of there and I went into this other treatment center to get my family back and to get my stuff back. That's why I was in there, see. I got out of there without going to jail. And I went into a real treatment center to do something. 3 weeks into this treatment center, I'm laying in bed and I'm thinking, I can't stand my life. Everything's gone that I value. I got 2 kids, 4 and 6 years old. Pam's taken them and left. I've lost my house. I've lost my family, my business. Everything is gone. Now it looks like I'm going to go to jail. And I said something I'd never said before. I says, I'll do anything not to live this way anymore. Anything. Soon as I said it, I felt these rushes going through my body, just waves of electricity. And it came through my head and down through my feet. One right after another, just waves of it. Like somebody plugged me into the light socket. I felt this peace come over me like I'd never experienced before. With a sense of knowing that everything will be okay if I just stick to the commitment I just made. Meaning I'll do anything. The experience was very peaceful. It was it was incredible. And then I get this in my head, a militant atheist. I get this, Jesus Christ. And I just, it set me back. I went, it shocked me. I just went, whoa, no, not this. I couldn't handle it, guys. It was just too much. And it's just what happened. I'm just reporting, okay? I said, no, I can't handle this. I pushed it out of my mind and the experience ended when I did that. I have never had trouble staying sober since that experience. It was shut off like a switch. It's never come back. 24 years later, no urges, nothing, gone. So AA never looked like a program of not drinking. Never to me. How right that is when you start to read this material. How right that was. I've done a lot of things right by mistake. Not because I knew what I was doing, just because I started to follow this book a little bit. But at this point, I hadn't read anything. So now I come into AA. And I've made this commitment, I'll do anything, and that decision is still in force today. I mean it. I am not going back. I will do anything. Then the anything started showing up in opportunities to do 12-step work. Part of an alumni association at the treatment center. We'd bridge the gap between AA and the treatment center. We'd bring people out to meetings. I'm going out to adolescent treatment centers. I'm going to detox. I'm doing all this stuff. Not because I'm trying to work a program, because I'm depressed and it's lifting me out of my depressions. There's nothing noble about what I'm doing. I saw value in doing 12-step work. It kept me out of all the pain of the loss of my life, see? So I'm doing a lot of this stuff. What we're going to read in this next paragraph happened to me as an atheist. I'll show you what I mean. It's astonishing, but it actually happened. I couldn't come to believe first. In fact, in one sentence, I can tell you, I took actions I didn't believe in, and I got results I couldn't deny. That's what's happened to me. I couldn't explain the results away. When you're an atheist, good things happen, I take the credit. Bad things happen, I give it to you. You know, while things were happening that I couldn't take credit for. Amazing. So here's what happened.
When we sincerely took such a position, all sorts of remarkable things followed. We had a new employer. Being all-powerful, he provided what we needed if we kept close to him and performed his work well.
I didn't think I was performing God's work. I didn't even believe in him. Yet, solutions to problems are unfolding in ways I never could have imagined the solution coming from. Okay? And all I'm doing is I'm out doing 12-step work. I can't get my family back. I can't. Everything is a mess. And she didn't come back. I had to deal with that. See? Yet somebody or something is providing for me what I needed. And I didn't have any sense of what that might be, but it was happening.
Established on such a footing, we became less and less interested in ourselves, our little plans and designs.
You know, depression is being interested in yourself, your own little plans and designs. There's nothing more depressing than thinking about yourself. Have you tried that yet?
Yeah, go in the dorm tonight and think about yourself for an hour. Let us know how it comes out.
Yeah. So this is a break.
More and more we became interested in seeing what we could contribute to life.
What can I give to life? Do you see what they're doing? Reversing the selfishness. Do you see? Selfishness is the problem. Now we're reversing the selfishness.
As we felt new power flow in.
I did.
As we enjoyed peace of mind.
I was starting to have that.
As we discovered we could face life successfully.
Yep.
As we became conscious of His presence.
That wasn't yet.
We began to lose our fear of today, tomorrow, or the hereafter. We were reborn.
I was having a reborn experience as an atheist. So when I hear guys say, I can't do this because I don't believe in God, I don't buy that. That's not my experience. My experience is, you can do this, regardless of what you believe in. Remember, we're talking about the third step. And these are third step ideas that were... Remember, the question was, what do we mean by turning our will and life over to God, and just what do? This is what we mean, and what you do. This is precisely what they're talking about. Does it matter whether I believed in God as others believe? I was having this experience, and I didn't believe at all. That's the amazing thing. I didn't see that until later. I was in harmony with love, and I didn't believe in God. So belief isn't what's necessary as much as the commitment. What if I made a commitment, I'll do anything? And then you follow that with whatever shows up. This is exactly what happened to me. I didn't think I was working the third step. I saw it later. Yet I was working it perfectly. Because I wasn't thinking about myself. I was trying to help. I was trying to be helpful. My motive was terrible. If you had to get your motives right before you got to AA, nobody would get here. The purpose of AA is to change your motives for why you do the things you do. See? And that's what was starting to happen. Here's the prayer.
We were now at step three. I'm going to modernize the language just a little bit with all due respect. It makes it a little easier to hear. Many of us said to our Maker as we understood Him,
as we experience Him,
God, I offer myself to You to build with me and to do with me as You will. Relieve me of the bondage of self that I may better do Your will. Take away my difficulties that victory over them may bear witness to those I would help of Your power, Your love, and Your way of life. May I do Your will always. We thought well before taking this step, making sure we were ready, that we could at last abandon ourselves utterly to Him.
So what is this prayer saying? God, help me to be helpful. Relieve me of the bondage of self, selfishness, my need to take from life, that I may better do Your will. How could I do God's will if love gives? I'm out of harmony with God if I'm taking. Selfishness is the opposite of giving. Taking. Okay? So I'm asking God to take away my difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness to those I would help of God's power, God's love, not Rick's power, God's way of life. What if I made a decision to be helpful? Would I be working the third step? Would it matter if I believed in God? It's interesting to me that you can do this without a belief. It's a possibility. It's a great start. And as time went on, it started to induce experiences. This is what they're talking about. Guys sit there and try and force themselves to believe things they don't believe. Hey, once you experience it, you know it's true, whether you believe in it or understand it or not. You walk into this room, flip the light switch on, the lights come on. You don't have to understand electricity or ballasts or anything. Gas and a bulb, nothing to utilize it. Well, it's the same thing with this. I found if I can understand the software, the program, I can access it. See? So all I've got to do is be willing to move in that direction. I never thought I'd ever be able to come to believe. Yet it happened through experiences, not concepts. So the prayer is, God help me to be helpful.
Let me restate this line, because the first time I heard Rick say this some years ago, a big light bulb went out over my head. He took action he did not believe in. He got results he couldn't deny. Okay? He took action. He's pretty sure this isn't going to work. He's desperate. I don't believe in this, but I'm going to do it because nothing else is working. And he got results he couldn't deny.
Well, I did see it work for my dad. Even though I hated him, I couldn't deny that he was different. See? So it started to shift. It's a beginning. It's a beginning. It doesn't really matter what you believe in. The commitment carried me when I didn't believe. You following me? As time went on, I came to believe through experiences, not through concepts. I didn't find a concept of God. I found experiences I couldn't explain away. So we'll pick this up in the morning after this, and we're gonna talk a little more about selfishness and that sort of thing. So we'll see where this goes.
Thanks, guys.